Recorded Books presents Lovely, Dark, and Deep by Justina Chen, narrated by Nancy Wu. Once in a while, you get shown the light in the strangest of places if you look at it right. Grateful Dead. In the beginning, God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. So much light that 4.54 billion years later, give or take a couple of million, it was just about to kill a girl. Say, me. Chapter 1.
"You promised, guys," my little sister grumbles as she adjusts the gun belt slung low on her hips.
"And I delivered," I tell Roz, gesturing to the mosh pit of balding and hopefully starving men congregated before the doors of the Museum of Pop Culture, a full 2 hours before it opens. They are the perfect captive audience for my bake sale. "Behold!"
"They're old, and they're playing dress-up. They're in character."
I don't point out that so are we. Roz, nice and covered in my original costume, a faux leather vest stretched to the point of ruin. Me, exposed in a flimsy slip dress I wasn't planning on wearing today. But Roz is right. Little kids in costume are cute. Girls geared up as some of the most fearless women in sci-fi history. Fierce. 40-something men dressed as their favorite characters from a TV show. Vaguely creepy. Even creepier. Guys older than our dad are staring at my not-so-little sister, fresh from an elite rowing camp and with the muscles to prove it. Everyone here is just, quick, how would our parents phrase this? Expressing our appreciation for Firefly, best sci-fi series ever. "You're expressing something, all right," Roz emits a long-suffering sigh. "What's Firefly about again?" Think hot cowboys who fight bad guys in outer space. People actually watched this thing? People are still obsessed with this thing. Like my best friend and me. Ever since Aminta and I binged-watched the entire season on a single snow day back in eighth grade, we've been super fans. Hence, my grand plan. Sell out of the bake sale in an hour flat, then head into the exhibit, slap the HoloLens on my head, and compete in the bar fight scene. All great journalists need to be able to hold their own, whatever, whenever, and wherever the fight, on the streets or in a bar. And I, Viola Win Lee, am that. Once word leaked 6 months ago that Mopop was curating a special exhibit of Firefly, I've been prepping my spaceport bake sale stand to match my costume as Zoe Washburn, she of the fierce leather vest and second in command on the spaceship Serenity. But then, my parents announced last night that they had to be in Portland for an emergency meeting first thing this morning with a client who was having an epic crisis, which meant me babysitting Roz, even though she's in high school. And since Roz hasn't worn a dress in approximately 7 years, she got to be me.
"Who am I again?" she demands.
"Zoe," I tell her for what must be the 15th time this morning. "First mate and..." Roz interrupts with a contemptuous sniff. "So not me. I'm going to be crew captain by junior year. And who are you?" "River Tam, badass weapon in a dress and boots." "What's her weapon?" "She is the weapon." Even though my dress is breezy at best, I'm sweating, most likely from dragging the card table by myself from the station wagon parked 2 blocks away. Call me compulsive, but I straighten the already tidy pile of my latest article featuring today's bake sale beneficiary, a girls' education fund through CARE International. Now I set up the sign, lettered in Firefly font. "Join the revolution, geeks for good." And at the bottom, in smaller font, is the requisite legalese that my parents insist I include in accordance with King County public health codes, baked in a kitchen that is not inspected by a regulatory authority. Perfect. Roz multitasks in displeasure, picking at the blisters populating her palms, which, hello, is not going to help move a single baked good, and complaining. "It's the last day at Bumbershoot.
I could be listening to Blackpink. I could be sleeping.
I choose to ignore her operatic sigh. Besides, in the middle of her woe-is-me soliloquy, I'm suddenly not feeling in bake sale shape. It must be 95 degrees, uncharacteristically toasty for late August in Seattle, but I might as well be in the Serengeti with my aunt, the relentless sun pelting down on us. My forehead leaks sweat, and I feel oddly weak. But who cares if my face is beginning to feel sickly warm? I brandish a copy of my article, complete with my interview with the vice president of advocacy in charge of the education fund, and raise my voice at two oncoming older men dressed as brown coats. Buy a bow and help the 31 million girls who are out of school around the world. The brown coats veer away from me at light speed.
You're scary, says Roz, herself moving a stratospheric distance from the table.
I'm getting something from Starbucks.
By yourself? I ask, a mini mom. Can't you wait an hour?
Again with the sighs. As Roz flounces away, my fingers worry the leather lariat at my throat, Zoe's signature talisman I wear every single day. My right foot taps an impatient beat on the pavement. I was counting on obsession with this short-lived series, just 14 episodes before it got canceled, for a large turnout of hungry nerds and a rapid sellout of the bake sale. But there are zero takers for my painstakingly crafted, pillow-fluffy, individually packaged, good-for-the-world red bean buns. In Firefly, everyone speaks curses in Mandarin. Hence, Chinese dessert. Red bean bows. Clever, no?
Apparently not.
I fight a vague wave of nausea. I know one thing for absolute sure. I can't leave my station for some impending cold. Life with my parents has always meant living and breathing these issues, but now they matter even more to me as the next great foreign correspondent.
Educate girls around the world, I shout again, and shove an article at another brown coat who looks shocked but takes it.
5 feet away from me, he tosses my article, the one that took a good 10 hours to research, let alone write, into the garbage.
Hey!
Right when I'm about to stalk over to the garbage can to see if I can salvage my article, I realize I'm hunting the wrong prey. I shouldn't focus on old geeks, but perpetually hungry guys my age. How hard could it be to find one of those? I rise on my tiptoes, even though my legs are shaky. Miraculously, I spot my target. A broad-shouldered, ridiculously blonde, young Thorgon lumberman in jeans and flannel shirt. Before I can yell, bows, Thor quarter turns. He should be swaggering around Iceland, circa 12 centuries ago, brandishing a battle axe. But instead, he's making straight for me, like he knows exactly who I am and what I'm selling. My flowy dress feels like it's cinching my rib cage. The late summer sun is burning my face more than ever now. Where was Roz when I needed her? Thor sets a towering pile of comics next to my articles on the table. The cover on them distracts me from Thor himself. Not hard to do because a young woman is busting, and I do mean busting, out of her stripper outfit, pardon me, costume, an obscenely high-cut bikini bedazzled with stars. The title reads, Persephone from Planet X. More like Persephone from Planet XXX. I glare up at him. He is so not colonizing my private bake sale space with this ode to sexism. Excuse me, what do you think you're doing? I ask, just stopping myself from shoving his comics off. Let them be trampled. But then he picks up one of my articles, skims it, and tucks it in his front pocket.
Doing what most people do at bake sales. Buying one?
Thor digs out his wallet from his back pocket.
Actually, make it two.
My swim coach was in a foul mood today, super hard set. I'm starving.
Oh. But since when are pork humbows a hot bake sale item?
Red bean bows, I grudgingly correct him when he holds out a $5 bill. The barbecue pork wouldn't make it past Seattle's non-hazardous food code. I thrust two buns at him. As my parents say, the best offense is defense. So
I start to gather his comics to hand back to him.
Take one,
he tells me. No thanks.
Really?
He looks genuinely perplexed. My silence speaks eloquently for itself, if I say so myself. Unfortunately, my silence is a foreign language to him. Gesturing to the geeks around us, Thor continues,
A new superhero? Planet X, I mean, come on, this could drive traffic to you.
Sir, I say as I pass him his change, knowing that the iconic line was going to be thoroughly lost on him. I think you have a problem with your brain being missing.
Zoe, I'm desperate, he answers.
I blink up at him in surprise. He speaketh Firefly?
No one wants one. Besides, Aminta texted that I could sell my comic here,
Thor announces. My best friend, Aminta? Aminta? President of the Geeks for Good? Aminta, who conducted a private study proving that our teachers did, in fact, unconsciously call on guys more than girls in our science classes.
I eye Persephone's chest, a solar system unto itself, one that defies gravity, not to mention reality.
Whatever universe Thor and his comic hail from, I'm pretty sure that Aminta and I have never seen, heard, or wanted to populate it.
I'll donate all my proceeds to your cause, he says.
More like he'll drive traffic away from my cause. I prepare to give Thor a polite brush off, yet I swear I've been teleported to the Sahara Desert. The glare is so harsh. Still, it's not harsh enough to stop me from witnessing with my very own eyes the stealth moves that any pilot in any universe would envy. Roz, finally, returns with her iced coffee and maneuvers in front of me. Her back may be to me now, but I can feel the gale force of her eyelashes fluttering at Thor.
River on Zoe action. Nice.
Some balding guy snickers as he and his brown-coated buddy pass us. My hand automatically shoots out to Roz's arm, yanking her out of harm's way, even though she towers over me by a good 8 inches. I snap at them.
Yeah, and we can kill you with our brain cells.
My outburst saps me. I end up clutching Roz for balance. From my side, I hear Thor.
Very River Tam.
I try to glare up at him, except that the sun is so bright. I squint, lower my head. Too fast. The planet moves in dizzying circles. Thor asks urgently,
Hey, you okay? You're really red.
Roz finally acknowledges my presence and frowns. Whoa, Viola, you really are. Her hands fan her own face. Like, really red. Really, really red. She looks revolted.
And you're getting puffy.
The familiar hard guitar chords of Firefly's theme song strum overhead. Hundreds of voices roar their approval. The cowboy twang of the lyrics fills the air. Take my love, take my land, take me where I cannot stand. Let's go, I want to tell Roz, except I can't. I don't feel flushed. I feel faint. Not weak in the knees faint either, but faint, faint. Like I'm going to collapse in front of this guy faint. Like I'm going to be trampled by the great migration of geeks who are now thundering toward the opening doors. The earth buckles underneath me. I lurch. As I fall, Thor reaches for me, his arms tightening around me.
Call 911,
Thor says, his voice muffled in the ringing of my ears. I'm fine, I protest. At least, I think I protest. All I see is the answering blue sky of Thor's eyes. The theme song, my theme song, swells, mocking me. You can't take the sky from me. The world falls black, and my sky disappears. We have a situation. When your company is under cyber attack, the first thing you must do is calibrate the threat. Where is the attack coming from? Who is behind the attack? What is the damage? Li and Li Communications. Inside the war room,
The Crisis Management Playbook.
Chapter 2.
I shiver, cold with sweat, lion stalked in the middle of the savannah. My heart pounds, escape is impossible. My skin itches and prickles and stings, assaulted by legions of mosquitoes and tsetse flies. Waking from a dead faint is nothing like stirring from a good sleep, all groggy and blurry, wispy dream remnants floating away into the ether space of happy. Instead, I think, nightmare. Mom, I whisper. Dad?
My eyes blink open, slowly. There are strange men, and we are moving, and I'm lying in a cot, strapped down. For one panicked moment, I almost believe that I've been kidnapped. Isn't this the very situation that my parents warned me about when I turned 10 and was allowed to bike down the street by myself for the first time? What was I supposed to do to escape a locked van? But the men are in uniforms, crisp white shirt sleeves stitched with official-looking Medic One patches. One tells me,
"You passed out. We're taking you to the emergency department."
"Roz?" I ask. "My little sister."
"She's with your friend."
Friend? What friend? Then I remember Thor and fainting in front of him, not to mention hordes of strangers. And I've just met the guy for a nanosecond, and they left Roz with him? There are no words for this crisis. My parents are going to skin me alive when they found out that I've left her behind. As if the paramedics divine my thoughts, the older one with a buzz cut assures me,
"Your sister said that your parents are already on their way from Portland."
He gives me a grandfatherly pat on the shoulder, and I moan. Who jerks away first is unclear, and doesn't matter. I'm relieved that no one is touching me.
"Just rest."
I don't need to be told twice. I close my eyes. Where other, normal parents might hover and fret and liquefy into blubbering pools of utter incompetence in a crisis, mine shine. Of course they do. They're professional crisis managers. Throw in an emergency room, they'd go bioluminescent, glowing at the opportunity to come to my rescue. Only my parents aren't here. Which left me alone to contend with the on-call doctor at the children's hospital who ordered approximately 1,000,000,001 tests. A CT scan, a couple of vials of blood, and an EKG. And now I find myself the lab rat of a pediatric dermatologist who is humming and hawing in a not-so-comforting way in my new exam room in a different ward of the hospital. Dr. Anderson looks young enough, no stubble on his preternaturally smooth chin, to be sitting next to me in physiology, especially the way he's worrying his top lip like he's cramming for a test. He very well could be. As soon as I made it to registration in the emergency department, the nurse called Mom, who authored and emailed a mini textbook on my medical history in 10 minutes flat.
"Are you sure there's no family history of lupus?"
Dr. Anderson asks, peering at me like I'm a pickled organ he wants to dissect.
"Pretty sure. Was it just a heat stroke?"
I'd seen my Auntie Ruth have one of those during our trail run on Tiger Mountain when it hit 98 degrees last summer.
I self-diagnose.
I was nauseous and dizzy, and I fainted.
"No, you've a rash too," says Dr. Anderson. "Try not to scratch."
Which, of course, makes me notice that I am, in fact, itchy, and I do, in fact, have a blotchy red rash running along both arms. When Dr. Anderson returns to the intake form, frowning because Mom writes at the speed of her thoughts, rapid, dense, and always indecipherable, I surreptitiously check my phone. My parents ought to have all the answers about my condition any moment now. Instead, there's a text from Aminta. Aminta.
"Are you okay?"
Me.
"Where's Roz?"
Me.
"And how's the bake sale?"
"Could your mom have forgotten someone?" Dr. Anderson asks, looking up with his finger on the lupus question, then frowns at the sight of me with my phone. I quickly pocket it.
"Somewhere in your family?"
"Not a chance."
"Huh, Obviously, the good doctor has zero clue who my parents are. The principals and co-founders of Li and Li Communications, who can transform the very worst crises into media darling gold. All questions are locked down, checked off, and sealed shut with solid answers. So if Mom says there's no lupus in the family, then that is as indisputable as the fact that the sun will always rise from the east. My phone buzzes. Maybe it's my parents, I say. The doctor nods. But it's Aminta again. Aminta. I took Roz to Bumbershoot. Aminta. What's wrong with you? Aminta. Literally, who cares about a stupid bake sale? I do, because it's never just a stupid bake sale. Not to me, anyway. As Li and Li have intoned through the years, we speak for the speechless. They view their corporate clients as their waiter job to pay for all of their pro bono work for nonprofit humanitarian groups. Well, I bake for the powerless and homeless and everyone in between. But just to make sure that I'm not dying, I ask the doctor, lupus isn't fatal, is it? Lupus is a possibility, not a diagnosis. Oh, wait. Dr. Anderson grins as he holds up a finger, as if that is good bedside manner, and says almost gleefully, I've got an idea. I'll be right back. Even before he's safely out of the room, I begin to research my symptoms with the intensity of a scientist on the verge of a major breakthrough, pecking blurry fast on my phone. BBC reported that cell phones don't really interfere much with medical equipment. Too soon, the doctor returns. I tuck my phone to my side. I don't have any of the classic signs of lupus. No butterfly rash on my face, I tell him, and hope I'm right since I don't have time to fact check with the mirror. Perhaps, Dr. Anderson concedes reluctantly, yet I can see his jaw tighten with frustration, the same way Dad's does when he can't resolve a client's problem. But being sensitive to the sun is a common sign of lupus. Emphatic tap on the iPad screen he's holding up to me now. Photosensitivity, which can also be caused by vitiligo, porphyria, maybe xeroderma pigmentosa. None of these sound particularly benign. What's worse, I'm back to being scared, flailing around without concrete information. So I ask, okay, worst case scenario, am I dying? Just then, a blur of navy blue and motorcycle boots sweeps into the room and stops at my hospital bed. It's Auntie Ruth with her distinctive scent of motor oil and cedar and risk. Viola, no, you're not dying, she says immediately, her brown eyes snapping with conviction. It's a very good thing that my skin no longer burns, since she wraps her arm tight around me, then glares at the doctor. Did you tell her she's dying? The doctor audibly gulps. How could he not be in awe? Auntie Ruth's wearing her usual uniform, custom-made mechanics coveralls from Tokyo. She's got one in every color of the rainbow. Today's front pocket is embroidered with her first name in hot pink, and the back features the winged logo of her auto repair shop. The waist is cinched in to accentuate her curves, and the pant legs are rolled up so you can see her beat-up boots that are scuffed gray from overuse on a real Harley, not distressed at some factory. The uniform is so sexy, utilitarian cute that Aminta has been coveting one. But Auntie Ruth believes it's important that every woman create her own signature look. Sorry, I got here as soon as I could after Roz called, Auntie Ruth says to me before turning her attention back to the doctor. I'm Viola's aunt, so what's next? We need to run tests, Dr. Anderson says, all clinical efficiency now. Not a hmm or huh in hearing range. I eye him suspiciously. Because what tests could possibly remain? Or more likely, is he trying to impress my aunt? Yes. Was decisiveness a doctor's way of flirting? Apparently. Was it working? Hardly. I wish your dad was here. He'd know why you'd fainted and what's up with your skin, mutters Auntie Ruth, completely missing how the doctor looks more crushed than offended. I jump in to explain, to smooth things over with him. My parents specialize in crisis management for humanitarian organizations. You know, tsunamis, earthquakes, famine, endangered animals. They always know what to do and say in an emergency. But Dr. Anderson has found his own way to resuscitate his authority and says to Auntie Ruth, "Wait, it says here she was on malaria meds."
"Yeah, for a trip to Ghana," I answer, even though he's addressing my aunt, not me.
"And Tanzania?"
"With me," Auntie Ruth says.
"Really?" Dr. Anderson asks her, interested, as if that fact has anything to do with my current condition. "I've always wanted to go to Africa. What brought you there?"
Auntie Ruth tells him. "A college friend of mine was filming a documentary on child trafficking. Then we went on a short safari."
"That is so cool."
Dr. Anderson's eyes grow appraising until they drop to the wedding ring Auntie Ruth still wears 5 years after Uncle Amos died. Under any other normal conditions, I'd shove her number at him myself. She's single. Since she looks clueless as ever, her man radar at a permanent loss. But now, I need info.
"I took Doxy for a month," I blurt out, "and finished 2 weeks ago."
Dr. Anderson blinks, as if finally realizing that he's not at a club. I feel at a distinct disadvantage, prone, so I scoot up and swing my legs off the bed.
"Was it the meds?"
Auntie Ruth demands, her hands knotting together.
"It's possible she may have had a phototoxic reaction from the meds,"
Dr. Anderson grants. At Auntie Ruth's alarmed gasp, he adds quickly,
"It's one of the known side effects. But 2 weeks after stopping the meds, that'd be highly unusual, almost impossible."
"Phototoxic?" No matter what anyone could say now, that word sounds ominous. Deadly. Something you'd read in an obituary. My legs stop swinging.
"Generally not fatal," Dr. Anderson says. My heart goes into double time.
Fatal? Fatal as in lethal fatal? Fatal as in death fatal?
"Fatal? Oh my lord, this is all my fault,"
Auntie Ruth says, folding her arms across her chest.
"Why didn't I just listen to your dad? Mick was totally right, as usual. I shouldn't have taken you with me."
Her eyes well with tears.
"I can't believe I did this to you."
"There's only about a 1 in a million chance that it's the meds,"
Dr. Anderson soothes her, as if she's the patient with the generally not fatal diagnosis.
"In fact, the half-life of Doxy is no more than 22 hours, so it'd be out of her system in 2 weeks, which means the chances of it leading to death are even more infinitesimally small."
"Leading to death?"
Auntie Ruth vows,
"We are so not going on your graduation trip anymore."
"What?" I ask, startled, because I've been counting on that whitewater rafting trip and all the other ones we've planned.
"I'm not putting you in danger ever again."
Her intense expression looks eerily like Dad's when he's about to issue a non-negotiable parental veto. My stomach churns in a familiar doomsday way.
"Auntie Ruth can't nix our plans to take clandestine trips, Jordan, Mongolia, to prep me for my clandestine career, foreign correspondent, after I attend my clandestine college, New York University, in Abu Dhabi, for 4 years. That's where I've planned to fulfill my journalistic destiny, since the campus is strategically located, so I can travel as fast as breaking news anywhere in Africa, Asia, and the Middle East. Kiss goodbye to embedding myself in Abu Dhabi, learning Arabic, and reporting on that part of the world if I can't even get into a tiny little rubberized boat."
"Probably a good idea to stay out of the sun as much as you can until we know for sure what's going on,"
Dr. Anderson advises.
"Wear sunscreen whenever you go out. You're stabilized enough to go home now. We'll get you scheduled for some photo tests next week."
"Home,"
Auntie Ruth echoes, nodding,
key fob already clasped in her hand.
Home? People, I want to say. I have bows to sell out, a cause to champion, the exhibit of my lifetime to see, a Thor to avoid. Thor. Did I really faint in front of Thor?
My cheeks burn, but my self-respect doesn't matter.
I have to go back to Mopop.
It's true. Thor or no Thor, my bake sale calls.
Oh, honey, I don't think so, says Auntie Ruth, shaking her head.
Dr. Anderson agrees.
You really want to stay out of the sun for the next couple of days.
A lanky nurse comes in with a sheet of paper that he hands to me while Dr. Anderson explains.
That's some info on photosensitivity. I'll give you a call tomorrow to check in on you, especially if you have any questions.
But what if Thor's still trying to offload his misogynistic comics on my bake sale stand?
I get up, grab the edge of the cot, and pretend that my legs aren't wobbly. Not at all. Then I catch my reflection in the mirror and freeze. The rash on my arms may be fading, but this is no ordinary blush on my cheeks. I am not a lovely, demure shade of English rose. No amount of foundation or concealer or special effects makeup artistry could camouflage this. My skin is a field of molten lava.
This is stabilized?
Auntie Ruth says, Thanks, Dr. Anderson. We'll book the photo tests for next week.
Wait, we're leaving? I have to go outside? I want to protest now.
No, more accurately, I want to crawl into a ball, shield my head and my arms, never go out in public again. But the floor is covered in millions of microbes, and the worst thing that could happen is for me to get MRSA on top of everything. Maybe they're right. Maybe the next best thing is to hurry home.
Home, where I'll be out of sight.
Home, where I can plot my makeup Geeks for Good bake sale. Home, where I can sequester myself in my bedroom while my parents parse my condition to their heart's content. The elevator doors ping open. Just as I break into a straight run for the parking garage, I grind to a stop.
What's wrong, honey?
Auntie Ruth asks, concerned.
Do I see my parents blazing a path across the hospital lobby to quash this crisis? Do I see Roz with Aminta and the rest of the Geeks for Good beside themselves with worry?
No. Instead, it's Thor?
Chapter 3.
Thor? Who's Thor?
Auntie Ruth asks, scanning the lobby until her gaze stops on the blonde, broad-shouldered one hulking his way toward us.
Oh, behold.
Indeed.
Auntie Ruth nudges me. Just how do you know him?
I'm still stuck on the fact that I uttered my code name for him out loud. Did photosensitivity fry brain cells along with skin cells? Apparently. Not all of them, because I recall my lobster skin with perfect clarity. Panicking, I turn my back on all that impending Thor.
Okay, time to go,
I tell my aunt, hoping she'll ignore the squeaky high pitch of my voice, not to mention the inconvenient fact that we have to pass Thor to get to the parking garage.
Muscles. Natural or steroids?
She asks quietly.
Shh.
Auntie Ruth sidles closer to me.
I'm just...
I know you were off boys after what Darren did. She lifts her head to cup my cheek, but thinks better of touching me.
Oh, honey, I'm so proud of you. You're way braver than me, just like I told you in our tent. Auntie Ruth,
but isn't he a little old for you?
Stop!
I cast an anxious glance over my shoulder. I swear, everyone, nurses, doctors, soccer moms, a pigtailed toddler strapped in her stroller, swivels around to watch Thor stop in front of me. Oversized muscles aren't his only superpower, as it turns out. The mere presence of his wide blue eyes fringed with criminally long eyelashes is enough to erase a girl's ability to form a simple hello. I really, truly didn't think it was possible to embarrass myself even more. Wrong. Totally wrong. His stubbled cheeks. Just how old is he? Obliterate all language skills acquired over the last 18 years. I gurgle. Ugh. Auntie Ruth, unlike me, extends her hand, all poised and put together, as if we're in her auto repair shop, not the children's hospital. Ruth Peters, I'm Viola's aunt. Josh Taylor, Thor responds as he shakes her hand. No steroids. Seattle Central Community College, 18. We just met at Mopop. I have a vague memory of getting lost in his big sky blues before I fainted. I ask him, met as in, did you break my fall? Josh slash Thor shrugs, shoves his hands in his pockets, shifting his weight. He mumbles,
I was closest to you.
Wait, what about my bows? I blurt out. He hesitates.
I've got them in my truck.
No one stayed to sell them? When Josh grimaces apologetically, it's obvious no one wanted to buy them. What am I going to do with 200 red bean buns? The thought of all those snubbed bows just about demolishes me. And I feel like a failure, and my eyes well up, and I want to cry. But I know it'll be ugly weeping, and I already look bad enough as it is without snot running out of my nose. And I've already hit my humiliation quotient for one day.
Hey, I can bring them to my swim practice tomorrow with your articles, Josh tells me.
Auntie Ruth pipes in. That is so nice of you. Then to me, isn't that nice of him? Exhausted now, I would like to self-immolate on the spot, right here, right now, please. The second best option is to burrow home, not deal with anyone's curiosity, let alone become a curiosity. And in the way that hundreds of clients before me have raised the red flag, rescue me, and had their SOS call answered. There they are, my parents, at last. Li and Li burst through the sliding glass doors, straight out of a blockbuster action film. Mom, the petite redheaded queen of the fairies. Dad, her Mongol warrior, who prides himself on being descended from Genghis Khan. Mom likes to point out that most people today are.
Viola, honey!
Dad booms across the lobby, hurtling toward me. Luckily, just as he's about to bear hug me, Mom touches his arm, a swift warning. He draws back before his protectiveness can inflict damage, while Mom scrutinizes me up and down, then up and down again, even as she's digging in her leather tote bag for her water bottle. She holds it out to me, insistent.
Drink. You need to hydrate.
Mom!
We got here as soon as we could, Mom says, her voice choked up. But weekend traffic. How are you doing, honey? Drink. You need to drink.
Mom's eyes may fill with tears, but Auntie Ruth is leaking them as she cries.
It was my fault. Mick, you were right. Africa was a bad idea.
Dad, who is the first responder for crises with just the right calming words, now sighs with nothing to say. As if Josh is the trained crisis manager, he introduces himself to my parents. A perfect diversion. I chime in. Josh caught me when I fainted.
Really?
Dad says, remembering his manners and extending his hand.
Michael Li.
Really? Mom says, coos.
Siobhan Li.
Dad pronounces his next statement in a way that he's never greeted a single guy who's taken me to a school dance, not even Darren, who oozed charm.
Son, you're coming to Super Bowl Sunday.
Then finally, he says to my aunt,
It's going to be all right, Ruth. We're going to figure this out. Okay, I'm getting answers now.
Dad gazes once more at me before striding to the registration desk. Josh slash Thor inclines his head slightly at me.
Super Bowl Sunday?
Which reminds me of the raw meat condition of my face. I duck my head, wishing my hair was longer so it could shield me. I mumble.
Grab a bowl of soup, cheer for the Seahawks on game day.
Mom refocuses her attention from Dad, who's interrogating the registration nurse, back onto me.
You know, that could be too much for you, honey. We'll cancel Super Bowl, just to be safe.
Somehow, I have dropped into a time-space hellhole. Super Bowl Sunday, Josh, the public, my face. What are these people thinking? Apparently they aren't. Actually, I'm doing great. I should get started on the soups. I seize on that reason to bolt. Auntie Ruth can drive me home.
No, I'll take you, Mom decides, overruling Auntie Ruth's feeble protest.
Our go-to babysitter whenever our parents are on a business trip or dealing with an emergency has been demoted. And now, Auntie Ruth looks hurt on top of guilty. I can only imagine Mom's hypervigilant hovering over me at home. So I encourage her.
Mom, you should go research with Dad. I can go with Auntie Ruth.
Your dad's got it under control, but I'll let him know our game plan. Then to Auntie Ruth, Mom says,
Really, Ruth, thanks for being here for Viola, but I got it from here. We'll talk with you later.
With that dismissal, Mom sprints over to Dad at the registration desk.
Okay, then. I guess I'll call you tonight, says Auntie Ruth, hugging me ever so gently. Her sigh is grief deep. It's probably a good thing I was never a mom.
Auntie Ruth?
But she's already racing out of the hospital, her shoulders hunched. I glance at Josh, who must have some mad superpowers, because if my family is weirding him out and my raw hamburger face is disgusting him, he isn't showing it. Instead, he's watching my parents.
Honestly, by the time my parents are fully satisfied with the entire medical community's answers, I'll be graduating from college, ready to make the world a more informed place.
The skittish way the registration nurse jumps out of her chair to go do something, flee my parents. One can only imagine what they said to her.
Mom flutters her eyes up at Dad, and then they kiss. As in, mouth on mouth, my hero kind of kiss.
Josh clears his throat uncomfortably. I can't even muster a sideways peek at him. Awkward doesn't even begin to describe the moment.
Well, they sure are into each other, he says.
That's one way to put it, I tell him.
It's kinda good.
If you mean good like a horror movie can be good, then maybe, I suppose. Then I whack him on the shoulder.
Wait, no. In no universe is this possibly good. You have no idea what it was like to be in preschool when they dropped me off on the first day of school, and then actually made out in the front seat of our car when they thought no one was looking?
I pause for breath, my eyes wide.
We were all looking. All of us, noses pressed up to the windows looking, crying for our moms looking.
Did you all stop crying?
Yeah. Well, effective then.
Crisis contained. That was one way of looking at it. I preferred to look at him and the way his right cheek, and only his right cheek, dimpled with his smile.
But what am I thinking?
Josh is obviously the same kind of player as Darren. A guy who goes for impossibly proportioned, sun-kissed blondes glowing with health. A hearty and hale Viking woman to his rugged He-Man Thor.
See, Persephone. Not me. Pippi. I barely squeak above 5 feet tall with curves that could be politely called petite. And hair that is a confused brown. My one asset are my eyes. Large as Mom's with a mysterious tilt. Courtesy of my genes from Genghis Khan, by way of my dad. I use that asset now to side glower at Josh. But my glare is lost on him and his obscenely wide shoulders. He's studying the empty space where my parents had been standing, kissing at the registration desk, as if he were measuring the residual isotopes of their attraction. Whoever they've slipped off to interrogate now, I feel sympathy. Lots of sympathy. Josh asks, they're your bio parents?
Unbelievably, yes. In a blink of an eye, boom, love. I can't contain my blathering now. Literally, Dad ran public relations for a pharmaceutical making eye drops. Mom was a crisis communications consultant called in when the eye drops blinded people. And then they bonded over the whole Lee and Lee last name thing like it was fate. And then both of them wondered what they were doing, wasting their lives, working for big corporations when they wanted to save the world. I mean, who falls in love and creates a business to save the world together during a crisis? Seriously? They did? Josh turns a penetrating gaze on me. All that concentrated male focus makes me nervous. I fidget, not knowing what to do with my hands. So, Josh says, Super Bowl Sunday, River Tam? I'm about to correct him that while I might be cosplaying River the Weapon, I'm 100% Zoe the Commander to the core, all contained and 100% controlled. But my chest prickles where my shirt is unbuttoned. I tentatively touch my hot skin. I cannot possibly have sunburned, or worse, broken out in another rash just by standing here in the lobby. Could I? I'm getting your parents, Josh says, worried. No! Then I'd be dragged right back to the doctors. I just need to go home. Mom's perpetual crisis echolocation wings her back to my side, like she senses my distress. The doctor warned about this. Not a moment too soon, she and Josh whisk me outside to her trusty Volvo sedan and buckle me in. I wave goodbye to Josh, mostly relieved, but also weirdly regretful. When I lower my hand, it grazes slick paper sticking out of my messenger bag. A copy of Persephone. In thick black permanent marker is a phone number under his message. River Tam. My brain will, in fact, be missing until I know you're okay. Text me. Josh. The worst case scenario. The best offense for any kind of crisis is advance preparation. Where are your vulnerabilities? What is the very worst thing that can happen? Lee and Lee Communications. Inside the War Room, the Crisis Management Playbook. Chapter 4. Name a cause, any cause, and I have mixed, baked, and frosted for it. 49 consecutive bake sales since fifth grade, all of them successful by any measure. Money raised, baked goods sold, satisfaction of beneficiaries, all of them themed. Bite-sized gingerbread houses that perched on mugs of hot chocolate for a group benefiting refugees. 3D cookie trees for Treehouse, which supports foster kids. Giant gingerbread people iced in gowns and tuxes for the exchange, which provides free formal wear to anyone who needs it at school. All of them accompanied with a well-researched article complete with interviews with subject matter experts. I've never once bailed on a bake sale, not even when I had back-to-back-to-back finals during junior spring, not even when Auntie Ruth's husband, Uncle Amos, died of pancreatic cancer 5 years ago. Not until this morning, that is. But a few minutes of losing consciousness and a fading rash are not derailing my track record. Not when my future as an NYU-educated and Middle East-embedded foreign correspondent might depend on it. The moment I spot Aminta's denim blue Prius in our driveway, back from Bumbershoot, I feel the first sense of calm in this whole, long, tiring day. I will make things right. So even before Mom comes to a full and complete stop, I shove the passenger door open. Or at least, I try to. The door feels like a herd of mama elephants are pushing against it. Elephant rescue mission. Pecan cinnamon elephant ear cookies. Bake sale 2013. Viola, be careful! Mom warns me as my boots hit the pavement. How can I slow down? Adrenaline, sweet adrenaline surges, so I pound up the three steps to the front door. My house key slides into the lock at the same time the door opens. It's not Roz greeting me, all, "How's my big sister?" but Aminta Sarabhai, my big-hearted, big-haired best friend from second grade, who is still in her firefly costume, like she couldn't be bothered to change until she sees me. "I'm sorry about the bake sale," I tell her. "Shut up about the bake sale already," Aminta says. While she has many, many superpowers, what tops that list is her ability to give grandma hugs. Warm, encompassing, and reassuring. Only today, my body tenses, my skin supersensitive when she embraces me. "Careful, Aminta," Mom cries. Immediately, Aminta releases me. "I'm sorry, did I break you?" Then, looking down at me, her eyes grow round. "Oh my gosh, you're red." "Yeah, and I will be for an entire day," I tell her. "Oh good, first day of school's on Monday." "I know, lucky me." "You better get inside," Mom says, waving us both into the house. She bolts the front door behind us hastily, as if she's blockading an enemy. Once inside, I peer into the living room and ask Aminta, "Hey, where's Roz?" "Bedroom," which is code for pouting, which is precursor for getting whatever Roz wants. Aminta and I learned the early warning signals the hard way. A few big tears rolling down Roz's pudgy cheeks, and my little sister got the first choice, the best portion, the biggest serving. Once when we were six, Aminta openly questioned Roz's right to have the last scoop of chocolate chip ice cream, our fave of the moment, and she split it between our two bowls. Roz's face went horror movie enraged. I had to get Aminta out of the kitchen fast before Roz cried and my parents intervened. Even though I heard Roz waddling behind us, "Wait for me," I ran even faster with our contraband bowls. Then, Roz stepped on a nail left out from our remodel. It pierced her foot and she fell. The blood, I'd never seen so much blood. The wails. We all thought she was dying, and it was my fault. A few stitches, one tetanus shot, and a giant cast later, Roz returned home, victorious with not one, but three tubs of ice cream, all Sharpie markered with her name. "Sorry," Aminta whispers, shaking her head. "I just couldn't tolerate one more K-pop band at Bumbershoot. I know the tickets were expensive, but I wanted to be back here when you got home, so we left early." I can only imagine the conniption fit Roz threw. "I'm sorry." "You should go rest now," Mom tells me. Irritated, I sigh. "I'm not an invalid, you know." Fighting is futile, though, especially with Mom casting worried glances at the expansive kitchen windows. Anyway, I want to talk to Aminta about our bake sale and Josh. So I grab her hand and we tiptoe past Roz's bedroom, blasting chirpy notes of K-pop. "Just to be extra safe from eavesdropping," I whisper to Aminta as I close my door. "We're going to have a makeup bake sale."
"What?"
Aminta splutters, then Whisper yells at me.
"Again, who cares about the stupid bake sale?"
"I do."
I plunk myself down onto my bed and scoot back to rest against the wall. My whole body relaxes. "You know our plan. Donate so much to care that we might actually be invited on one of their field trips to Nepal or India and get the real scoop." The grand plan was for me to write about our on-the-ground experience and Aminta to turn those facts into infographics, complete with her hand-drawn comics and number-crunching skills. We are the geeks for good, after all. Geeks who were censored in our school paper our freshman year because the administration refused to allow us to publish our investigative report. Aminta's data crunching that proved that teachers unconsciously favored boys in STEM classes. The school did not appreciate her accompanying political cartoon any more than they did my article with interviews with the leaders of the local chapter of the Society of Women Engineers, who had choice words and even choicer examples of institutional sexism. So we decided to go rogue, report on causes that mattered, and distribute our articles through innocent bake sales, both on campus and off.
Can a handheld apple pie have an ulterior motive? You bet. When it includes information about our vets, who risk their lives for the sake of our freedom and return home with untreated PTSD. So, we'll have a do-over on Friday. I nod my head firmly. Never mind that I have no idea what I'll bake to substitute for the bowel failure, or that my body feels so achy tired that the thought of making soup in the morning drains what's left of my energy. Tomorrow I'll be back to baking shape, and this health blip will be history. Everyone's going to be ready for a sugar high after the first week of school. True. The teachers always lay it on thick for the first couple of weeks to scare us. Don't they understand it's senior fall? Don't they know how many college essays we need to write? Don't they know we'll sell out then, especially if we sell before the back-to-school dance? We should make an extra big batch. I interrupt this monologue because the same one's been playing in my own head this whole summer with one major variation. My parents have no clue that my early decision college choice is NYU Abu Dhabi. Not only that, but if I get in, my first step is to snag an internship with a field producer for any of the major news outlets. Okay, good idea, but only if I help bake this week, Aminta says. I know Caress will too. Nah, I got it. She spent so much time making her costumes for today. My leather vest that I didn't even get to wear. You never let us help. I do too. You guys donate the ingredients. I donate the baking time. There's a light rap on the door before Mom enters with a tray loaded with popcorn, carrots and hummus, water, and Josh's comic. You know, Mom muses as she sets the tray between Aminta and me on the bed, it's a little weird that the main character is photosensitive too. Persephone? She is? I ask as Aminta gasps with a loud, no way, I totally forgot that part of the plot. She leans forward for a better look when I flip through the pages. We were in the same comic class. Remind him about Super Bowl Sunday, Mom says. Mom. Well, good thing I did then. Mom, you didn't. Even Aminta groans, covering her face with her hands. Crisis manager's my foot. My mom isn't smoothing over an incident. She's creating one. Mom, we didn't give him our address. Just living up to our word, honey. Eat up, Mom says. You need your strength, sweetie. That eat up is a beacon calling all little sisters to stalk into my bedroom and frown, outraged at the injustice of our tray of food. Hey, what about me? Rosalind, honey, let's get you something too. Not a moment too soon, Mom leaves with Roz, thankfully closing the door behind them. This is terrible, I say, rubbing my eyes. There is nothing I can do to fix this situation. So I do the next best thing, which is to barrage Aminta with questions. What do you know about him? And why would you tell him he could co-opt our bake sale with this? I jab my finger at the twin peaks on the cover. This! Aminta digs a carrot stick into the hummus and takes a thoughtful bite. I'm kind of shocked Josh finished it, actually. The gavel slams in my head. Case closed. So he's a slacker. I thought so. Well. Aminta shoves a couple of pieces of popcorn in her mouth, like she needs serious reinforcement before answering. It's just so tragically sad. He and his twin were working on this, and then suddenly they both stopped coming to camp. And then we heard that Caleb. His twin? Aminta nods. Well, we heard he died. That's awful. Horrible. What happened? I don't know. Aminta studies the cover of the comic. We didn't keep in touch, not like some of the other kids and I did, but then Josh texted a couple of us late last night and said that he had published Persephone. Not just finished it, but actually published it with a short-run press. She shrugs. I just wanted to support him, and we were having the bake sale, and it was the Firefly crowd, and it seemed like the right thing to do. Yeah, of course it was. I'm glad you did. On the wall across from us, I've pinned all 50 of our Rebel articles.
It's hard to get published, as we know.
I pick out my favorite pieces of popcorn, the ones that are shy of burnt, the ones that slipped through the Siobhan Li carcinogen filtration system. He waited for me at the hospital.
Josh?
I nod. Isn't that nice? Aminta shakes a carrot stick at me.
Oh, no, you don't.
What?
That's code for, isn't he nice?
I blush, because pretty much, yes.
Well, all I know is, Aminta says, crunching down hard on the carrot before waving the remaining stub at me. He was always nice to a different girl in class, before class, and after class.
Darren 2.0. Just what I didn't need in my life ever again. A guy who'd toy with me when it was convenient for him, texting to get his ego fix, angling to get his physical fix. I set Persephone face down on my bed. Don't worry, not doing that again. Then I groan.
Wait, Super Bowl Sunday, my mom texted him.
He won't show.
You're right, he won't. Of course not. Showing up meant following through, which players do not do. Following through is the Lee and Lee way, no matter how grueling the assignment. Following through is why I'm insisting on Friday's bake sale. Only now, my body betrays me when I should be charting all the details, researching cookies to make, outlining the signs to create, composing social media announcements to blast. I curl up on my side, a little ball of tiredness.
Should I go? Aminta says, concerned. Get your mom?
No. My eyes close, but the sunlight is bright behind my lids. I turn my face to the wall. I'm just going to nap for a few minutes.
Aminta slips to the ground with the comic. I'll read. You sleep. Go on, stretch out.
Instead, I stay where I am, according to my plan.
Chapter 5. That night, I dream of the Serengeti. Endless plains that stretch brittle green and yellow gold to the horizon and beyond. Air steeped in sun-dried heat. There's no drizzling rain, no soft mist, no persistent ceiling of low gray clouds that is the Pacific Northwest. Yet I feel more at home here in the restless savanna than I ever have in Seattle. The roof of the touring Jeep is popped up, and Auntie Ruth and I stand in our seats, leaning out and breathing in sunlight and red dirt. Ready? Auntie Ruth asks me, grinning with a wild delight, just as she has since she invited me on this trip of a lifetime. I lift the camera in my hands.
Ready.
After a day on safari, I'd learned fast to be prepared for my shot. You never know what the Serengeti will unveil to you, moment by moment. As it is, the hum of life is ever present. A leopard growling deep in its throat from a faraway tree. Hyenas cackling through the tall grass. Elephants trumpeting somewhere in the thicket. A lioness is hunting.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.